Would a high protein diet damage the kidneys in a diabetic, especially if one has high blood pressure and uncontrolled blood sugars? Has modern science now exposed the two biggest contributors to the destruction of these critical organs? If lowering your A1C, losing weight, gaining muscle, while improving or maintaining kidney health is your primary goal, then this is the episode for you. Welcome to the Resilient Diabetic. This is the channel we turn ordinary, struggling diabetics into extraordinarily well-controlled diabetics. If you are new to this channel, I welcome you. My name is Jay Sampat. Don't forget to subscribe and hit that gray notification bell. That way you will be alerted when new life-changing episodes have been published. And most importantly, if you learned something new today, please smash that like button for me. As with all my videos, this should not be considered personal medical advice. This is my interpretation of the latest research. If you want medical advice, please always consult your physician. As I have mentioned in many of my videos, when I majored in nutrition dietetics, one of the biggest battles I faced, especially with my hardcore indoctrinated professors, was over the consumption of protein, especially for strength athletes and bodybuilders alike. Most, if not all, the studies done at that time, especially on protein intake, were compiled from aerobic-based sports. I knew instinctively the recommended amounts were set far too low. But this field of study is very political and one-sided in nature. It is staunchly pro-carbohydrate, very anti-fats, and anti-protein. Fast forward 25 years later, as I became a late onset insulin-dependent type 1 diabetic due to an autoimmune attack, protein consumption has become even more paramount to my health and yours, as a matter of fact. Many endocrinologists, doctors, and even most nutritionists are averse to us diabetics and a high protein intake. Is this why the fastest growing model in the world happens to be the explosion of dialysis centers popping up everywhere? And who makes up the majority of their new client base? It's diabetics. Something does not quite make sense here, so a little history lesson has to be in order. Back in 1984, Dr. David Brenner, a researcher from Harvard, worked exclusively with diabetic rats and kidney health. But here is the key. When he ran his initial experiments, he held the rats' blood sugars at around 250 milligrams a deciliter. I'll explain the importance of this in just a few minutes. Brenner basically proposed that the habitual consumption of excessive dietary protein, not the high blood sugars he kept them at, negatively impacted kidney function. He not only turned the world upside down with this one extremely flawed rat study, but his experiment was then taught at every medical school around the world. All of this was told thanks to Dr. Bernstein, who was there as part of those initial presentations. I will create your very first incredibly important link to the entire mind-blowing video in the description box below. But before we discuss what really damages the kidneys, we must kind of rewind again and first understand, what do they do? The kidneys are a pair. Yeah, you've got two of them. They're bean-shaped, about the size of your fist, at the back of your abdomen. Each kidney produces urine that drains into the bladder 24 hours a day. The critical regulation of the body's salt, potassium, and acid content is performed by our kidneys. They also produce hormones that affect the function of other organs. For example, one set of hormones produced by the kidneys stimulates red blood cell production, and another produces the active form of vitamin D. The kidneys also help regulate blood pressure and control calcium metabolism. They both remove the waste products and drugs from our system. In short, the kidneys are like the waterworks department in a big city, and the two most common causes of kidney damage are due to high blood sugars and high blood pressure, both of which damage the kidneys' delicate blood vessels and tissue. Why does this happen? In the case of diabetes, high blood sugars over long periods of time causes glucose to bind to vital proteins in the bloodstream. And you have to know this name. It's a process known as glycation. It ultimately injures not only the very delicate filtering systems of the kidneys, but your eyes, your nerves running up and down the body. In other words, high blood glucose levels directly physically damages the tiniest of blood vessels running through our bodies. With high blood pressure, the problem is simply too much pressure, exposing the delicate filtering portions of the kidneys to blood that is moving too hard and too fast causes scarring. Thus, it damages the kidneys, leading to chronic kidney disease and eventual kidney failure. The bottom line, the best way to prevent damage and failure is to treat both high blood sugars and high blood pressure at the same time. Let's first start with a study, and I'll show you how politics and agendas work to push the high carbohydrate model. This is all done through using manipulated observational studies, and these, unfortunately, are the studies your doctors are exposed to. For example, this first observational study followed 2,255 patients aged 60 to 80 with a history of heart attacks. They not only filled out a standard food questionnaire, which I have explained are both inaccurate and highly reliable, but they also received the GFR test, which is a measurement of kidney function over the 41 months. Observational trials like this provide weak data and are often comprised with uncontrolled, confounding variables. For instance, in this study, those who ate 1.2 grams per kilogram of body weight per day of protein averaged 2,250 calories per day. Those who ate less than 0.8 grams per kilogram averaged 1,346 calories per day. That's almost 1,000 calorie difference per day. But wait, there's more. The high protein consumers ate 268 grams of carbs per day, compared to 173 grams for the low protein consumers. Finally, the high protein group ate 1,300 milligrams more sodium than the low protein group. While sodium may not be all important on a low carb diet, on a high carb diet, sodium intake does correlate with poor health outcomes. Why? And I've explained this before. As your carb intake goes up, so does your insulin requirements. Insulin then instructs your kidneys to retain sodium. This then leads to added blood pressure. Based on those GFR tests, the author's final conclusion? The high protein intake led to a rapid decline in kidney function. We can also conclude that the group that ate more carbs or sodium had more rapid decline in kidney function too. They just all happen to be in the same group. So then, what was the true culprit? Was it the protein, the carbs, or the sodium? Or could it have been something completely different that wasn't even measured? Because remember, our main hypothesis is this. If blood sugars and high blood pressure are controlled or even reversed, the long-term damage those conditions cause to the kidneys can be slowed or prevented completely. And how does one do that? It starts with the right diet, or, in other words, the right composition of that diet. We do still have to ask that question. When would dietary protein intake be a concern for kidney health? Well, when the kidneys are damaged, one of the first signs is protein leaking out of the kidneys and appearing in the urine. Because of this, some hypothesize that eating too much protein might cause additional stress, causing more damage. And because people associate low-carb diets with higher protein intake, this leads some to wonder if these low-carb diets lead to worsening kidneys. If you do have advanced or end-stage kidney disease, you must work closely with a qualified medical profession to establish your individualized diet that is best suited for you and your condition. For the latest study, researchers followed 143 adults with type 2 diabetes, an average age of around 61, who followed the low-carb model over 2 years. This diet was based on the guidance that participants should reduce their intake of starchy and sugary foods like breads, potatoes, rice, and replace them with other options like vegetables, leafy greens, berries, nuts, full-fat dairy, eggs, fish, and meat. While this diet was initially designed to improve blood glucose control, they also carefully measured kidney function because the participants, one, they had diabetes, they were advanced in age, and there was also an increased protein consumption. Not only did the participants actually improve their kidney function over the course of 30-month study, but so did their blood pressure, cholesterol, and triglycerides. What's more, the participants lost an average of 21 pounds and their A1Cs improved by an average of 2%. In fact, 47% achieved a drug-free type 2 diabetes remission, meaning their blood glucose numbers were below the range associated with diabetes. This very well done study has completely discredited all previous reports that have claimed high protein intake promotes renal damage and that low carb diets themselves may increase the risk of cardiovascular complications. But just like that very first study that we discussed on rats, which is still taught in medical schools, the flaws are, one, they're either observational studies, two, they're animal studies, but in both cases, they try and blame the protein instead of looking at the nature of our modern eating patterns high in processed carbohydrates. When carbohydrate intake is high and one cannot control their blood sugars, then protein intake really matters to kidney health and it must be limited. The kidneys will deteriorate under those circumstances. The big picture, and I want you to think about it, is the explosion of dialysis centers due to diabetics eating too much protein? Is it filled with bodybuilders like myself who eat 3 to 4 times the recommended amounts? No. It's filled with patients who are following the recommendation of our experts to snack and continue eating excessive carbohydrates around the clock. You moderate, remove, control, or even restrict the true cause, the excessive carbohydrates, and then and only then is the body capable of healing itself. Maintaining and keeping your muscle tissue is the single most important task that we as diabetics have towards normalizing and controlling our blood sugars, which leads to living that long, independent life free of complications. And that is all done by eating the right amounts of protein. So I bet many of you have additional questions like, how much protein does a diabetic need per day? What are the best kinds of protein? I'll set up a playlist for you with more answers to these great questions. And I'll even expose more deceit and misunderstandings doctors and nutritionalists are still taught to this very day about this vital macronutrient. The first link you will see will be to subscribe to this all-important life-changing channel. The second is the link to the playlist on protein. protein. So have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which are generally released weekly. Bye for now.